Okie and hello, my pals and petit pois. Good to see you all, albeit virtually. I am Tad. I will be here until about an hour from now, which in my time is from 1 a.m. to 2 p.m. 2 a.m., excuse me. I'm not going to be here from 1 a.m. to 2 p.m. That would be, what, 13 hours? No, not quite up to that. But anyway, I'll be here for about the next hour. I will be reading, juggling, tap dancing, you know, all my usual tricks. I'm very glad to have you with me. There was something else I was going to do here. What was it? I'm going to open that up. So if I have a moment of hesitation at some point, it's because my computer has decided that all of my commands, you know, command keys on my keyboard have just gone. Don't ask me why. I don't know. You know me. Technology loves me. but anyway, so if you see me going like, whoa, wait a second here, that's probably what's going on. Anyway, but I don't expect it will have much effect because I don't actually have to do many keys while I'm doing this. If I was writing, if I was answering, you know, like a Reddit AMA or whatever they're called, then yeah, that might be an issue. But I'm not. So, hello, good to see you. Nice to have you with me. Not a whole lot to report here, although the cats are hopped up on Nip. So my daughter just informed me as she went out, sorry if the cats are a bit nipped. So, you know, there may be some kind of crazy juvenile delinquent cat behavior in the background, but I doubt that will trouble any of you very much. What else? Anything else going on? Nah, nice day today. Just kind of hung out, did some mental work, but not much more. Needed a day off. So had that, and I have no complaints about that. Anything else to tell you about? No, I don't think anything's changed much since last week. I'm working on a last sketch for one of the maps of Navigator's Children. I have now finished up the redraft of The Heirs of Ordinary Farm, and that is now with a couple of people to read, one of them being Deb, of course, who wrote the first draft and is the co-creator of the work. And let me think, anything else? No, just a lot of family biz, stuff like that. Did you take the brown acid, PJ? You better get to the bummer tent. Anyway, so that is what's going on here. I don't think there's much else going on at the moment, which I, you know, that's a good thing. I'm not complaining about that. I'm perfectly happy to have no excitement whatsoever. Today was definitely a low excitement day. So I just was able to do a few things that needed doing around the house and stuff like that there. Anyway, anything else? No, let me check in and see who has showed up. I see Holger. Hello. Christina, Chris Fab, Suzanne. Hello, Suzanne. That's Suzanne Owen. Jeremy. Hey, buddy. Good to see you. Nikki. Hello, Nikki. Pleasure to see you, too. Hazel, my mother-in-law. Hi, sweetie. Loved everybody. I saw you on Facebook. Anyway, so very good to see you. Your daughter's doing fine. She's asleep at the moment. Although in her normal Deborah way, she was having a fight with somebody in her sleep when I came out to do this. But that's, like I said, that's nothing unusual. Wouter, hello, Wouter. Hello, Isaac, good to see you. Holger, I think I already said hello to. Yes, we're bringing people into the top. Boris, hello, Boris, good to see you. And I already said hello to my mother-in-law. Mwah, blowing kisses. Who else is here? Iris and Rosalba and Petra and Jessica Ashmore. Oh, there's a new name. Hello, Jessica. Ivan Skavinsky Skavar, my good buddy Ivan. And good to see you. Anamika, I don't think I said hello to Anamika yet, or Carol or Penny. And there's Mark checking in from Yorkshire, and there's Kristen. So it would not be a show without most of you. So I'm always pleased to see you. It is a small but select coterie of people. We are an exclusive club or something like that. I think it's just most people have gotten tired of me talking. But I don't really blame any of them, to be honest with you. So, anything else to talk about? Not really. You know, most of the things that are on my mind at the moment are not really writing related. I'm just, you know, I'm going through all the stuff that, people go through at my age, which is, I was actually talking to Deb about this today. Excuse me, I've got something in my eye. Oh, I can tell you one interesting story, which is that this is actually has two parts, so don't worry if the first part seems rather inconsequential. But anyway, I was woken up about 7:30 in the morning. You have to understand, I'm somebody who doesn't go to bed till 3 o'clock at least. but I was woken up about 7 o'clock in the morning with my large dog Johnny thumping me with his paw repeatedly, which is what he does when he's needy or worried or upset about something. And I looked over blearily, and Deborah was already up because she's a morning person. And so she was out of range. And so I just kind of petted Johnny and soothed him and said, "No, you're okay. You're okay, buddy. Don't worry about it." Because he has lots of, like, the doggy equivalent of panic attacks. He's on doggy Prozac and everything. Anyway, so I rolled over, and like a minute later, Johnny's like thumping me on the head again. He had big paws. He's not that big a dog. He's like less than 80 pounds, but he's got big old paws. He's thumping me on the head, bum, bum, bump. And I look over at him, and he's looking really, and I'm like, "Johnny, you're okay. You're okay, buddy." You know, because we do this a lot. When he's nervous or worried about something, he comes to me. And if it happens when I'm asleep, I don't always know what it was that set him off. So this happens one or two more times. I looked over to see if the door to the outside was open so he could get out if he needed to. And yeah, I thought it was open. So, and then finally I went, you know, "Okay, John, I get it. You're not going to leave me alone." This has been about 10 or 15 minutes at this point, and I kind of sat up in bed and realized, oh my God, no, the door was not open. The screen door was not available with the doggy door in it for Johnny. And the poor dog just wanted to go outside and have a wee. You know, I mean, that's all the poor guy wanted. He wasn't having one of his like freak out meltdowns or anything. And I just went, "Oh God, I'm so sorry," and jumped up and opened the door and left it open so he could come back in, or the other dog could go out if they wanted to, because little dog can't get out through the screen, through the doggy door. And went back to bed. Anyway, a couple of hours later, you know, 9:30, 10 o'clock, I woke up. And there's this like noise around me, and I'm like, "Oh crap, mosquitoes!" Or it's too early for mosquitoes. And I opened my eyes, and right outside the sliding glass door, which, you know, was still open from when Johnny had gone out earlier, there's like two dozen yellow jackets swarming right outside the door, and a few of them have already come in. And I still don't know why. I have no idea. There's no nest there or anything. I mean, there's undoubtedly nests on the property, but there was no nest next to the door or anything like that. For some reason, they had all just got up at the same time. There was nothing there to attract them, no food or anything. They're very lured by things like sugar and meat, yellow jackets are. I know from long experience living in the hills. None of that was going on, but there's like this whole cloud of yellow jackets. And it, for those of you in Europe that don't have that term, they're hornets. They're basically in the wasp family. They're, you know, they may even be wasps, but, you know, we call them yellow jackets. Anyway, so at that point, I like leaped up out of bed and closed the door, locking most of them out, and then had to go find a glass and a piece of cardboard and collect all the ones that had gotten in. And my wife came in and saw me like standing on a chair or something trying to like catch something up against the window. And so I'm trying not to hit it with the glass and break the sliding glass door, but at the same time, you know, yellow jackets are fast little buggers, right? You know, and they're just like so anyway, I finally got them out and took them outside. And Johnny didn't want to talk to me for like an hour afterwards because I had totally misread what was going on with him. So that was how my morning began. So when I say it was a restful day after that point, it was a restful day after the attack of the yellow jacket swarm and the conducting of the other yellow jackets back out of the house, because I don't believe in killing an insect unless you really don't have any choice, or you know they're like disease bearing, like mosquitoes and ticks. which aren't insects anyway, but mosquitoes are. So anyway, so that's how my day started. That's like the sum total of the excitement of the day. And from that point on, it was very calm and very restful, and I have no complaints about it whatsoever. Okay, so before I start reading, and there is Alexandra has showed up, and Maria Henschke. And Alexandra, I think I asked you, and I haven't seen yet if there was an answer. So if I missed it, I apologize, but I still would like to know how to pronounce your last name. If it's German, Lihop, but yeah, but that's a guess. Anyway, Suzanne says, I wonder if Tad was like this on KFJC, the community radio station. I was on KFJC for a long time, and I did a lot of different things there, but the primary thing I did was a political talk show, which is one of the many reasons that I'm not doing politics on this reading thing, because first of all, I've got, yeah, I had years of it. But second of all, because, you know, politics are divisive, and it's the same, you know, it's not that I won't state my feelings very clearly, and I do, used to all the time. I got tired of having arguments that were just pointless with people, but anybody who knows me knows my politics, and that I'm, you know, pretty lefty liberal in general, although I also consider myself to be a centrist and kind of a rationalist about a lot of things. But that's obviously, probably everybody considers themselves to be a rationalist, politically speaking. But I don't, you know, that's not what this is about. This is just about me reading, and I don't want to, you know, grade my readers or friends by whether their politics agree with mine perfectly or not. God knows, and believe me, I get as angry about politics as anybody. Just, you know, sometimes it's just really hard, you know, not just to stay calm and remain focused on whatever's in front of you when people are doing things that terrify you or enrage you. But on the other hand, I also feel very strongly that most people are all trying to do the same thing. They're trying to live decent lives, take care of their own, take care of people who obviously need help, but mainly just trying to live in a community and get along, you know, pay what they have to pay, do what they have to do, make something of their lives, et cetera, et cetera. So fundamentally, there's more that connects us than separates us. That doesn't mean that politics isn't problematic, and it doesn't mean that there aren't people that I feel have got the wrong end of the stick on things, but I really don't want to turn my entire life into having to grade people according to their politics. Obviously, if somebody is like out and out racist or homophobic or misogynist or whatever, that doesn't fly with me. But rather than saying to them, I will never speak to you again, I will say, guess what? I think you're wrong, and here's why. But I don't want to spend my entire life making divisions. You know, I think it's more important at this time that we try to connect with each other. And that's, although my parents are very political too and always contributed to a lot of things and a ton of charities, I feel so bad for all the charities that my parents were contributing to and then they died. You know, we can't afford to keep up all the payments that they were doling out. You know, that's what they were doing because they're, money has now been tied up in various things while we go through the estate. But, you know, so I mean, but my parents also were very big on trying to understand people even when they didn't agree with them and trying to find common ground and move forward as a species. So I guess I'm kind of more like in that Watchmen mode, like we need a giant squid from outer space to attack us so that we can all combine our humanity and be on the same side for once. But anyway, anything else I was going to talk about? No, if I'm given the chance, I'll just keep babbling, and that's not what I'm here for. Although I know some of you have a weird masochistic pleasure listening to me ramble. And I appreciate that. If I found, you know, like a kind of a fairly amiable crazy guy, I used to watch amiable crazy guys like me on the late night UHF stations when I was a kid growing up, even some who were like religious people, but if they amused me, I would watch them, you know. But so there, I'm sure there's some element of that and people watching me go, about whatever's on my mind at the moment. Unfortunately, you guys on this reading thing, you don't ever get any of my deep thoughts. Well, the things that I really think about a lot, like the nature of reality and stuff like that, because, it's just not appropriate and it would take too long to get into. And the kind of things that spur these thoughts would have to be explained first. And, Deborah and I are both fascinated by science and history. We are neither of us professionals, certainly not in science, but we're fascinated by it. So a good portion of our television viewing is of, various, we're very big on archaeology, but we're also very big on what we can understand of things like astrophysics and stuff, the nature of the universe, the nature of reality, all that stuff we're fascinated by. So I have all kinds of weird, perhaps even slightly interesting ideas on those, but you kind of have to explain the whole context first. So you ain't getting that right now. I apologize, or I congratulate you, depending on how much you would not want to have to go through one of my 40-minute explanations of something. But that doesn't mean that I won't occasionally veer off into things if the mood takes me. Anyway, so what I am now going to do is I'm going to start reading. Okay, so the last section we were reading was as Simon and Miriamel are having to part, because Miriamel is going to Naban to be present for the wedding of Drusus, the Duke's brother. And remember, the Duke is like the hand-picked guy that Simon and Miriamel put in charge of Naban, or his family is. They've supported that family. But it's the Duke's brother who is troublesome, and the niece of one of the people who's fomenting the trouble are getting married. But Miriamel, in the interests of doing a queen's job, is going to go to the wedding and try and broker some peace between these factions. Anyway, but she's going by herself. Simon's staying behind. And at this moment, although Lilia, this section is actually being told through Lilia's point of view, Lilia, their granddaughter, but it's Miriamel, the queen, talking to Rona, Countess Rona, who is her good friend. So let me just go back a little bit. So Miriamel is talking about, all of her worries and concerns and stuff like that. And she says, "Oh, I know, Rona, dear, don't scold me. We never understand anyone but ourselves when we're young, and we don't understand ourselves very well. But I watched Simon and Jeremiah." So she's talking about when she was a teenager. "But I watched Simon and Jeremiah and that page. What was his name? I watched them running around, and even when they were working, they laughed and they sang." She frowned. "Isaac. That was his name. Little fellow, but he had a lovely singing voice. Not like my Simon's honking." Rona laughed. "I stand near your husband in the chapel. I have heard him sing, my lady. When you say honking, you are very kind. Bless him. And he does love to sing, too." She sighed again. "Oh, don't get me wrong, Rona. I will miss him terribly. And he is not a fool, not at all. He will do very well whenever he takes time to think carefully. But I worry that something may happen that compels a sudden choice, and that is when I fear his judgment. I will do my best to watch over all your dear ones, Majesty," her friend said. "And don't forget, we will miss you too. And not just the ladies of the court either. All of Erkenland will miss you until you come back to us, my queen. I'll pray every day for your safe journey and speedy return. Ah, you have reminded me of something else." The queen looked over toward the children, and Lilia pretended to be studying the jackbones, which had been awaiting her next throw for some moments. "Aren't you going to go again?" Adenita demanded, sounding almost as querulous as her little sister. "Shh!" Lilia waggled her hand, wanting to hear what else the queen had remembered. I have heard a number of alarming things lately about Ernestir, the queen told Auntie Rohner. Most of them we've talked about already, but the latest reports suggest that things have grown very strange indeed in Hernesadhark. Please write to your friends who are still there, and without being too obvious, see what you can learn about Teleth, the woman that King Hugh is marrying, about anything, about Lady Teleth, Hugh, anything you can discover. Do not ask too specifically or too openly, but I would like some impressions of what goes on around the Hernestir throne that does not come from our envoys or other official carriers. Do you distrust your ambassadors? I trust nobody completely, dear Rona, except you and Simon, of course. But the news that comes to me from the Teg seems too strange not to be more generally known. Did you know that the Silver Stags have arrested and imprisoned several nobles who were friends of Queen Inawen? Lilia could see that Countess Rona looked surprised. Truly? I have not heard it. Why? I haven't been told yet. But I fear Hugh, especially since that woman got her claws into him. I will do my best to learn more. But discreetly, dear, as I said, and not just to keep my interests secret. Your husband still has many ties to Hernesadhark. Do not risk your family's safety. Risk their safety? Now you truly are frightening me, Majesty. Better that I frighten you into caution than lull you into carelessness. She smiled and raised her voice. Now, where is my granddaughter? The one I came to see? I could have sworn she was here somewhere. Lilia was pleased that her turn had finally come, although slightly miffed by how much time the queen and Auntie Rohner had spent talking first. I'm here, Grandmother. I mean, Your Majesty. You may certainly call me Grandmother, and especially today when I have to say farewell to you for a while. The queen beckoned to her, and Lilia got up and hurried over, then crawled into her lap. The queen always smelled of nice things. Today her dress smelled of oranges and cloves, and her hair smelled of violets. Why do you have to go to Naban? Because there is an important wedding there, and I want to attend it. Why isn't King Grandfather going? The queen smiled. Because he has to stay here and take care of the kingdom. Will you be gone long? Not too long. I'll be back before St. Granice's Day. Lilia thought. Will you bring me back something? Would you like a doll? Yes, a Naban doll with a great long stola. They don't wear stolas in Naban anymore, dear one, said Rona. Not for years and years, centuries. I don't care. I want one with a stola. Her grandmother stroked her hair. Look how golden you're becoming with all this sunshine. I'll do my best, lamb. I'll see what I can find. You can get one for Ada Nida, too, Lilia said generously. But not Eliweld. She's a terrible, terrible sniveler. But her grandmother was talking to Auntie Rohner again, and Lilia could only hope the queen had heard the important part at the end about not wasting a doll on little girls who blew and cried and told tales. She snuggled deeper, smelling her grandmother's smells, and wondered why people ever went anywhere far away. Next section. And the chapter house at St. Ormod's is to be rededicated on the Saint's feast day. That's coming soon. The Archbishop will remind you, I'm sure, but I'm telling you so you won't stay up late the night before. You know how easily you fall asleep at such events. I'm not a child, Miri, and I'm not such an old man either. No, but you don't do well at long ceremonies. Oh, and that reminds me, Earl Garrod is bringing his son for a naming at St. Sutrin's. You don't have to be there, but it would be good to invite him and Lady Devona to an audience afterward. Just say a few nice things about Nordheith and admire the baby, then send them on their way. Oh, and a gift. Jeremiah should be able to find them a nice silver cup or some plate. Remember, Nordheith is on Hugh's border, and we need to keep Garrod sweet. The Hernesteri are worrying me. The Hernesteri aren't worrying me nearly as much as the Norns. Of course, but we've already talked about that. Which reminds me, have you sent out the muster orders? No. But before you start poking at me, woman, I do know what I'm doing. We already agreed it has to be done quietly. If we start crying, the white foxes are coming up and down the countryside, we'll have a panic. Not to mention another 10,000 people trying to get inside the walls of Urchester. God knows what it would mean farther north. Farms abandoned, villages deserted, roads falling apart. So what are we doing now? What if they come marching down out of the north when the new moon comes? The Norns won't come in the middle of summer. They like fighting in the cold and dark because they know we don't. But even so, I'm sending out people I trust to talk to all the northern nobles. They'll understand the danger right away. And we'd have to warn them anyway, so all we're really doing is keeping it among those who must know now. I'm not sure. Miri, we met a single band of white foxes on the Frostmarch Road and had a letter of warning from a man we've never heard of, and the only thing we know for certain about him is that he was traveling with the Norns. I don't trust that horrid silver-faced witch up north any more than you do, but there will still be a harvest to bring in this year. And if we need soldiers instead, it will take a long time to get them. And if we tell them we need them this moment and then we're wrong, how long will it take to muster them next time? Or the time after that? It will be like the tale of the idle shepherd, I suppose. You know, wife, this isn't really what I thought we'd be doing on the night before you sail from the ban. I'm sure that's true. Which reminds me, the controller of the salt staple in Merrimond has to be replaced. He's a drunk, and he has his hand in the money box. Same for the controller of wool. We're not going to have any luck with Tostig. He has most of the wool staples in his pocket because he's smart enough to share his thefts. The Council of Urchester love him. Besides, you know he's another of Osric's cousins. Adon, bless us and protect us. That man has more cousins than a dog has fleas. Yes, but he's the heir's other grandfather, Simon. He feels he has the right to dip his snout into the High Throne's jar and eat as much as he pleases. And it keeps him sweet. Don't I know it? And without his 3,000 Falshermen and his Wentmouth levies, if it comes to a fight with the White Foxes, we might as well rename ourselves Southern Nornland. No jests, please, Simon. Not when I have to go away. Not when everything feels so fragile. This isn't a change of section, it's just a change of time. I'm sorry, I don't even know why I'm in tears. I just woke up feeling dreadful. Don't, Miri, don't apologize. But I don't like crying. It's an excuse for people to say, she's just a woman. I like holding you, though. Stop wriggling. Oh, very well, but just for a moment. It will be time for me to get dressed soon. I have so much to do. And in any case, Jeremias will be in soon, and I don't particularly like the way he chirps around here in the morning like a fat robin. He is doing his duty, beloved, nothing more. I know. Ooh, your hands are cold. You don't get away so easily. Besides, you know what they say. Cold hands, warm horn. You! Stop that. We have things to talk about still. Many things. And you're leaving tomorrow. Damn and blast, Miri, don't push me away. And what will happen if I let you? Afterward, you will smile like a dog in the sun, roll over, and fall back asleep while there are still important matters to discuss. No, I will kiss you first, many times, because I love you and I'm going to miss you terribly. Don't you still love me? Yes, you fool man. Most of the time, I love you to distraction. The rest of the time, the distraction comes on its own. But, as you know, we have other responsibilities now. Oh, God on his throne, responsibilities. I hate that word sometimes. And I miss the days when it wasn't like this. Don't you wish we could just do what we wished, go where we wished? I don't think I could do that, Simon. I don't think I could forget all the people who count on us. And neither could you, if I remember correctly. Not even when you were young. That's why you risked your life for Joshua and had to flee the castle. No, don't get up. Please, come hold me again. But be careful with those cold hands. I have just remembered about the Perdruanese factors. Not them again. Yes, them. If I'd known I was going to Naban, I could have arranged to meet them there, but they are already coming here. They'll arrive before the end of Tiagar month. They say that it is unfair to set the tariff so high for their grain because the farmers in the south have had a terrible year. So we will lower it. You cannot. Then the Northern Alliance factors will be angry, and our own grain merchants here in Irkenland will not be best pleased either. Why should we argue with Perdruanese traders in the first place? Because they are part of my grandfather's kingdom, part of the High Ward, and we have made promises to treat them fairly. No, I mean, why should we tell them anything at all? Why not let them decide for themselves what prices to set? Because farmers, shepherds, merchants, traders, they are all strung together like beads on a necklace. Do not pretend to be foolish, Simon. You know this. It is all one great thing, and we must pull the strands at one end to keep them tight at the other, and so on. Back and forth, back and forth. They could do it better for themselves, surely. Then they would not be under the High Ward, and would soon go back to fighting and killing each other. Have you forgotten about the old days before my grandfather, when Naban fought Irkenland and Perdruin, and Irkenland fought Hernestir, and everyone fought with Rimmersgard and the Thrivings men? That was why my grandfather, King John, brought them together under one throne, and why we must rule over them all, to keep them from killing each other. If the High King and the High Queen must decide what every single grain factor and wool merchant is to do, it seems to me that something is wrong. It also means that all the power is vested in the High Throne. Yes, that's what it means. What if the person sitting on the throne is, pardon my saying so, more like your father than your grandfather? Or like King Hugh instead of Aelair? Or like Drusus instead of his brother, Duke Salusaris? Morgan will not be like any of those. No, I hope not too. But what of Morgan's sons and daughters? What of the others to come? How long until a madman or a fool sits on the High Throne? I'm beginning to think there is at least one fool sitting on it now. Not to mention an ape with no manners. Did I tell you to start pawing me again? I'm sorry. You're right, Miri. I have no manners. But it feels so sweet when I squeeze you right there. Stop, you monster. Yes. Yes, I am. A monster who is going to miss you so fiercely that I will pray every day and every night for you to hurry back to me. Hurry back to me, my wife, so I can do this. Simon, please. Are there any other important details you need to give me? Let's call in Passivalis and the clerks to be certain. Surely there is a thread that some weaver in Cranhir has broken that I should replace. Or is there a fisherman on Firano's Bay who cannot earn his living until I mend his nets for him? That is not a net you are paddling, ape, nor are you a fisherman. So it works out well for everyone. Pig, tyrant, fool, great clumping fool of a husband. By the sweet mother of God, I shall miss you, and I shall miss you. No more talk. Kiss me. It will be dawn soon. Oh, what are you doing there? Nothing but my duty. All this talk of duty has inspired me to send the king's hand on a state visit. Simon, you really are like a child. Did you know that? An irresponsible boy. Then who is truly the fool? High Queen Miriamel. After all, you are the one who married me. But if you are ordering me to desist, save your temper, husband. I called you a name, but I did not tell you to stop. Chapter 51, Stolen Scales. Count Aelair remembered the name Kendrijaro from King Simon's stories, but he had never heard or seen anything to suggest that this bad-tempered relative would be the one giving the orders. The hierarchy of the Zedaya had seemed quite clear to Aelair during the Storm King's War. Lykimea and her husband were the royal couple, and their children, Jariki and Aditu, were prince and princess, or at least next in the line of succession. But either he had been wrong, or something had happened to change it. You say only our old alliance preserves our lives today, Kendrijaro, Aelair said. If so, we are grateful for your restraint, but I confess I am puzzled. Before you send us away, please tell me what I or my people have done to earn such words of scorn. You want to know what you mortals have done? Kendrijaro asked. Lied, betrayed, murdered. Is that not enough to deserve those words? Why is he saying that? Morgan demanded. That's not true. Count, what does he mean? I don't know, Aelair began. You saw Lykimea, cried Yajaro. You saw the mistress of year dancing, drowning in the long sleep. Your people did that. Aditu shot Yajaro a look that seemed to Aelair half anger, half pity. Not all mortals know what all mortals do, Sweetsa. They were men of this Saoman Snowlock's own kingdom. Yajaro turned to Kendrijaro. Uncle, you said yourself that mortal words are meaningless, useless, that those creatures do not know anything of truth. Morgan stirred and seemed about to reply. Aelair reached out and squeezed his arm, a little harder than he had intended, but the last thing they needed was an angry young prince making things worse. Saying so does not make it so, Yajaro, Jariki said. And Aditu and I can both promise that although many mortals are unworthy of trust, there are others whose words are as rooted in truth as those of the Zedaya. Saoman Snowlock and his wife Miriamel are two such mortals. Then tell me, demanded Kendrijaro, what Snowlock and his queen say about their subjects who attacked me and who nearly killed Lykimea and may yet prove to have caused her death. And what of our messengers? First Sijandi slaughtered, now Tanahaya attacked and poisoned. The red-haired Sitha suddenly went rigid, like a hawk spotting something vulnerable moving on the ground. Tanahaya, where is the scale she carried? Jariki almost looked uncomfortable. She does not have it with her. He turned to Aelair. Did your people find her possessions? Ehlers shook his head. I've asked Lord Passavalis, the one who found Tanahaya and brought her to the castle. He said her horse had vanished, and in her pack they found only some food wrapped in leaves. What is missing? What Protector Kreenjajaro seeks, what we are all curious about, is a mirror small enough to fit in the hand, said Aditu. Simon may have told you of these mirrors, which we Zedaya use to speak to each other over a great distance. Scales of the Greater Worm, they are called, or sometimes just witnesses. I know tales about such things. In legends, my people called it a worm glass, but I heard nothing of any mirror found with the wounded Sitha, Ehlers said. But another question is pressing me fiercely. Did you say you sent a previous messenger? Some years ago, by your reckoning, said Jiriki. When the attacks upon our folk began, we thought they must be the work of just a few ignorant mortals. But when they continued and grew more violent and yet seemed to be more carefully planned, we determined to send an envoy to Simon and Miriamel to ask them if they knew why these things were happening. Were there truly so many attacks on your people? Ehlers was beginning to have a very, very nasty feeling. What are they talking about? Morgan asked in a hoarse whisper. Are they saying my grandparents started some kind of war? Just let me talk to them, Highness, said Ehlers quickly and quietly. I will get answers for us, but the Scythi will not be rushed, especially now. Do I have your permission, Protector Kendrajaro, to answer Count Ehlers' question? Jiriki asked. It might be useful for us to find out what these mortals know, since they are here. But that will mean sharing what we know with them, and it will take some time. Kendrajaro inspected Ehlers and Morgan again. His scar-hooded eye made it look as though he doubted everything he heard, but at last he nodded and made a broad gesture with his hand. Bring them in, he said. Give them water and food if they need it, but not overmuch. They will not remain here long. Ehlers and Morgan were led from the dockside shelter farther into the forest camp, to a structure made entirely from a ring of living trees, which had somehow been coaxed into growing together at the top, so that their branches mingled in a single leafy roof. Spiderwebs hung between all of the trunks except the two that served as gateposts, and although it seemed to Ehlers that at least a few of the webs should be old or broken, they all appeared new and perfect, with each strand in place. The Scythi in this place seemed more serious than those in the first little boat, Ehlers thought, as if this were a military camp near the front lines of a battle. He saw no one singing or dancing, and Ehlers thought they watched him and Morgan much more closely than the first group of Scythi had. Or perhaps they are simply less interested in being courteous, he thought. He and the prince were given fruit and small loaves of bread on broad leaves that served as plates, and bowls of water so cold and lively on the tongue that it almost seemed like strong drink. When Ehlers looked, he could see that Morgan was enjoying the refreshment far more than he had expected to. When they were done eating, Jiriki said, "Much has happened since you and I saw each other last, Count Ehlers, at the crowning of Miriamel and Saoman. Soon after that, we had to decide whether to abandon Jaoe Tinukai, our last home, because it had been discovered by the Hikidaya, and we had been attacked there in the year of Inaluki's war." Inaluki was the Storm King's true name, Ehlers explained to Morgan. He was a Scytha once, before he died. I know all that, said Morgan. Ehlers was grateful that at least he seemed to be paying attention. Young princes were seldom very accomplished listeners, as he knew from long experience. Some years ago, Jiriki continued, as we struggled with our own disputes and concerns, We began to hear of attacks on our people in the southwestern part of the Great Forest, not far from our abandoned city of Daichikiza. This has always been important territory for our people, so when we heard that mortals were responsible, Erkenlanders, by their clothes and weapons, Saomans and Miriamel's own people, we were disturbed, but we had known centuries of ignorance and distrust, and even hatred would not evaporate simply because a mortal throne had changed hands. So though we hunted the attackers, we did not blame your king and queen. Which was foolish, as it turned out, said Kendra Jaro, sipping from a cup made of carved horn trimmed with silver, as I had warned. A swift look, the merest glance, flickered between Jiriki and Aditu, before Jiriki continued. But as years passed and more attacks happened, many of the victims were innocents out gathering necessary plants or acting the sentry along our forest borders. We knew something was truly wrong. May I ask how mere mortals could have wounded Sithi? Aelair asked, especially sentries that I presume were armed and prepared to fight. They were lured, Count Aelair, explained Aditu. Their mortal attackers were not striking out in surprise and a moment's fear. They were not just angry peasants. In one case, our people went to investigate a crowd of mortals felling trees in a part of the forest that, by our agreement with your high throne, was not for mortal use. But these tree cutters were merely the bait. Other mortals were waiting in ambush, and when our people came to see what was happening, they were attacked by bowmen firing from cover. Alesia, mother of God, said Aelair in astonishment. Brynioch of the sky, someone actually set traps to try to kill Sithi. How could you think this was anything to do with Simon and Miriamel? Most of our people didn't, Jiriki said. Not at first. And some of us still do not, Aditu added, because we know better. Jiriki nodded, though Aelair thought he looked less certain than his sister. But then we sent Sijandi of Kinau Vale, Jiriki continued, who had once been a companion of Saoman Snowlock, your king. Long ago on the mountain that mortals call Urmsheim, Sijandi was directed to travel to Azwa, the Hayholt, as you call it, and learn the truth. I confess I still hoped it was all some mistake. Just tell the story, cousin. Yajaro's voice was tight with anger. Tell what happened. The tale clearly meant something different to him than it did to Jiriki. Sijandi was sent to your king and queen, continued Jiriki, the mortals who had promised us that things would be different, but we never heard from him again. Some 2 years later, as you would count it, we found the rotting remains of his saddle and equipment in a meadow south of the forest. The scale that Sijandi carried, the sacred mirror with which he was to send us the words of the mortals, was gone. There were arrow holes in his saddlebag. No other trace of him has ever been found. Aelair could feel the sadness as well as the anger of those gathered around him in this odd open room made of trees. The Sithi were few, and although their long lives seemed nearly endless by human standards, they could die like any other creatures. Also, they bore children only rarely, so each death further diminished the tribe. I am sorry to hear about Sijandi, the Count said at last. I did not know him, but I know of him from King Simon's stories. Still, I can promise you without hesitation that neither Simon nor Miriamel had anything to do with such a horror, nor know anything about it. I have to believe it is our old enemies, the Norns, who have the most to gain as well as the best chance of doing such a thing. Have you not listened, mortal? Yajaro leaped to his feet. By what Aeolir had seen of the Scythi, Kendra Jarrow's nephew was practically trembling with rage, dangerous as an angry young god, his hair like a holy flame. These murderers were mortals, mortals like you. We would have smelled the Hikadaya's touch on any of these crimes. We have never stopped watching them, especially in the Forbidden Hills. Silence, said Kendra Jarrow, and for once his anger was not directed at the intruders. You are to remain quiet, Yejaro. You speak too often without thinking first. The younger Scytha dropped back into a crouch, his golden-skinned face studiously empty once more. This curious exchange finished, Aditu now resumed where her brother had left off. The disappearance of Sijandi frightened us all, she explained, and sharpened the argument about whether we should remain in Jaue Tinukai, a place we all knew was no longer secret. Most disturbingly, because it had been discovered during the war by the Hikadaya, it led to the death of our beloved Amaterasu, the mother of the Zedaya. The Scythi all made the same fluid hand gesture of sorrow. Aeolir knew about the attack and Amaterasu's death because young Simon had been present, still a captive. What a blow that must have been, Aeolir thought, to lose the wisdom of so many years in one treacherous blow. A blow directed by Queen Utuku, Amaterasu's own great-grandmother. What are they talking about? Morgan demanded of Aeolir. I don't know all these names. I'll explain later. Until then, listen and learn as best you can, my prince. This is a history older than mankind. Then, just a short year ago, while we were camped far to the west of this place, Aditu went on, our mother, Likimea, and Sue Kendrajaro and their company were attacked by a troop of mortals. Are you sure it was not merely a group of panicked huntsmen? Aeolir asked. There are many false rumors about the Scythi that pass for truth among mortals. Impossible, said Kendra Jarrow. Our uncle is correct, I fear, Aditu told the count. 80 mortals, more or less, waited for a Zedaya hunting party of a dozen. They attacked without warning. Arrows flying. They chose daytime, clearly knowing the advantage we would have over them in darkness. Kendra Jarrow pointed at Aeolir. The Scytha's ravaged face made every word terrible. Know this, Hernestir man. Those killers were prepared for us, taught by someone who knew our ways and skills. The Erkenlanders lay in ambush on a trail we use but seldom, so they must have waited a long time. They had disguised their scent as well. Then they attacked without warning. We lost half our company in the first volley. Does this sound like a chance encounter? No, I agree it does not. Aeolir suddenly felt every one of his many years. The Scythi were right. This was no mere misunderstanding to be softened by diplomacy and careful words. In fact, it was a puzzle he could not solve here and now, and perhaps never would. Who could have done such a thing, and why? Except for this very reason, to sour the friendship between the Scythi and the mortal rulers of the High Throne. My king and queen are innocent, I promise you, but still I grieve to hear your tale. Grieve. Kendra Jarrow made a gesture as dismissive as the slice of a knife. You do not know grief, mortal. The mistress of our house, our queen, as you would have it, was cut down before my eyes. My kinsmen died all around me. I alone escaped, carrying Likimea's arrow-pierced body across my shoulders, watering the uncaring earth with her blood and my own. Morgan stirred at his side again. Aelair knew they were walking a very narrow path now, with disaster close on either side. Once more he grabbed Morgan's upper arm and gave a warning squeeze, then said, I hear everything you have said, and it pierces my heart. Protector Kendra Jaro, do not forget, unlike all but a few other mortals, I have met Lekimeia. I know her wisdom and her strength. But why are you so certain that these were Erkenlanders? Did you hear them speak? Pah! Kendra Jaro's laugh was pure scorn. They did not even shout to one another as they killed us. More proof this was an ambush, pure and simple. But in the past, the Scythi have had conflict with many mortal races. The Nabanai of the Imperium, and closer in time, the Rimmersmen, when they came out of the West. Why are you so certain this attacking band was from Erkenland? Because I found something, the Protector said, on the leader of our attackers, whom I killed before the rest retreated, dragging his body away. I will get it, uncle, said Yajaro, then rose and loped from the tree hall. He returned a few moments later with a leather sack in his hands, which he passed to Kendra Jaro, who took the bag and turned it upside down. A cataract of gold coins slid out, clinking and chiming as it puddled on the ground before his booted feet. See for yourself, he said. Aelair stepped forward with Morgan close behind him. The Count picked up a handful of them, felt their heaviness, saw the sharpness of their edges. Gold thrones, he said. Not just that, said Jariki, the first time he had spoken in some while. Look closely. Aelair lifted one up to the light that streamed through the spiderweb walls. Bagba, bite me, he murmured. It's the lady and the lock. Each new minted coin had portraits stamped on both sides. Queen Miriamel on one, her husband, King Simon Snowlock, on the other. This particular issue of Gold Thrones had been made in Erkenland under the careful rules of the High Ward, the first of them minted only a few years earlier. The Count looked helplessly from Jariki to Aditu, who could only stare back, then turned at last to Protector Kendra Jaro. I cannot explain this, Aelair said, but that does not mean there is no explanation. No matter, we do not want explanations, said Kendra Jaro, nor anything else your kind can offer. We want you gone from our woods and our ways, mortal. Since you so value their kind, Jariki, you may be the one to lead them from our lands. And you mortals will leave the horn to Tuno, which has returned to its makers. That is all. And that's the end of that section. And rather than start a new section with 1 minute to go, I think we will put a bookmark in there for later today. And with that, I will begin to wrap things up. So hang on, let me get rid of that first. Okay, so, he said loudly. Thank you so much. Very, very good to spend time with all of you. I am so pleased to get to spend time with you. I will be back at 7 p.m. to read some more for whoever happens to be around, whether it be degenerate Yanks like myself or anybody else in other parts of the world that find that to be a convivial time to listen to reading. And with that, I say, again, thank you. Please take good care of yourself, take good care of your friends and loved ones, and if you have any spare care, left over, try and keep an eye on people around you as well. As I've said before, sometimes even just a kind word, a smile, that can really make a difference for people. So, with that, I say peace, my